Hi! So, it is that time of the year again where we talk about the mid-year book freakout tag. I mean, I know everyone says it, but it is actually true. The year flies by, and every single time that this tag comes along, I'm like, shit, it's happening already again. But I always love seeing other people do this, so here is my version of it. I'm gonna talk about stats first a little bit. Until so far, I've read 16 books and 6,067 pages, which is like an average of 380 pages per book, which I think is really quite high. I read mostly medium page books. Some of them are fast paced. And what else can I tell you? Yeah, my average rating is a 3.72 out of 5 stars. So I feel like that's pretty high, actually. I have to say, I thought I would read less than I have until so far, which means that I have been able to create some time to enjoy one of my favorite hobbies, which is good. That's a good thing. Let me know your stats until so far in the comments down below, because I am just curious. And remember that if you've read 3 books this year, that's totally amazing. If you've read 50 this year, that's totally amazing. Reading is reading. Reading is fantastic. And now let's go on to question number one, which is, what is the best book that you've read in 2022 until so far? I have to say that is an easy answer for me, and that is Beach Read by Emily Henry. Emily Henry has just sparked a love for me. She has opened a chamber in my heart that I didn't know existed. I read this when I was on vacation, and it felt like this has been the first book that I have been able to just like completely focus on and fixate my mind on in a really long time due to my mental health. I don't want to talk about it in every single video, but I do, apparently. I'm sorry. In this one, we follow two writers, and they are actually kind of rivals, and they find out that they are staying at this like lake house situation and that they are neighbors. They have one struggle. They are both in an extreme writing slump, writer's block, however you want to call it, and they decide that they're kind of like switch genres of the type of books that they write. January is a hopeless romantic. She writes romance books, and Gus, I think he makes like literary fiction. So they switch genres and get to know each other, and you know, they maybe fall in love. Emily Henry writes extremely well thought out romances, and I feel like the characters are actually overall quite grown up. They don't make any dumb irrational decisions that I sometimes see in other romance novels, and I don't particularly enjoy that. It's so good. It deserves all of the hype and more if you have it on your TBR, and if you don't, put it on there, and if you have it, go read it, okay? It's so good. Says a not so huge romance reader, so that truly means something. What is the best sequel you've read this year? And I have to be honest, which is something that happens every single year to me, I don't read a lot of sequels. And literally the only sequel that I have read this year is What's a Girl Gotta Do by Holly Bourne. This is the third book in the Spinster Club companion novel series. So it's kind of a sequel, but not really, because it's a companion novel. And in this one, we follow Lottie, and she is a vlogger, and she is gonna call out every bit of like sexism that she sees basically anywhere that she walks, on the street, in advertisements, at school, in literature, stuff like that. She calls it out, and she kind of like makes a documentary, puts it on YouTube, and it goes viral. And this book really deals with what comes next, how kind of like the activist gets talked about, the effect of the activism. I really enjoyed it, and I still really enjoy reading about this friendship group. I think it's a very solid YA, and Holly Bourne is one of my favorite YA UK authors. Number three, a new release you haven't read yet but want to. And I am never up to date with the new releases, so I was lucky that I could pick out a book for this question. I have Gallant by V.E. Schwab. I think it's YA, I think it's horror, but I'm not too sure, and I have also heard very mixed opinions about this one, which I'm kind of sad about, because V.E. Schwab, or at least like the A Darker Shade of Magic series and Vicious, I thoroughly enjoyed those. A quick synopsis, here it says, 16-year-old Olivia Pryor is missing 3 things, a mother, a father, and a voice. Her mother vanished all at once, her father by degrees, and her voice was a thing she never had to start with. Her only companions are the ghouls she sees and her mother's journal, which captured a mind in turmoil. And I don't know, it sounds and looks like the perfect Halloween read. You know what I mean? Like, it sounds mysterious, but I've heard it's a bit boring, which is sad. By the way, I've also read Addie LaRue and quite enjoyed it. But will I like this one? That's the question. Let me know if you've read it and what you thought about it. What is my most anticipated release of the next half of the year? Again, I feel so good for having an answer to this question because every single year, I barely have one. Let me grab the book though. Ooh. Oh, by the way, you could also ask like, wait, do you already own this book? Yes, I do. I have an ARC. I feel honored. And that is Daisy Darker. You cannot really see it, but it's Daisy Darker by Alice Feeney. Last year, I kind of discovered that I really quite enjoy murder mysteries and thrillers. Last year, I read Rock, Paper, Scissors by her, and she writes psychological thrillers, I would say. Oh my gosh, this one was so good. If you like a wintry setting, creepy vibes, but in a thriller book, you should pick this one up. And I saw that one of my friends, Olivia from Olivia's Catastrophe, received an ARC of Daisy Darker, and then I reached out to the publisher and I was like, I would love to read another Alice Feeney. What is this book about? On the eve of Halloween, Daisy Darker arrives at Sea Glass, a crumbling Cornish house perched upon its own tiny private island to celebrate her mother's 80th birthday. Her eccentric Nana believes this will be her very last birthday and has gathered her family to hear her final will. The Darkers haven't all been in the same place for over a decade. When the tide comes in, they'll be cut off from the rest of the world for 8 hours. I always love that kind of like separation from the real world thing. Anything could happen, you know? And when it goes out, they'll never all be together again. As the clock strikes midnight, Daisy is horrified to find her grandmother's sinister premonition has come true. Above her body, a haunting poem has appeared on the kitchen wall. Someone is coming for the Darker family, each and every one. But with the island cut off from the mainland, who can the killer be? Yes, yes, I want to read you. Question number 5, my biggest disappointment. I have two. I don't want to talk too much about them because they are just really quite bad. We have All These Bodies by Kendra Blake. This is a paranormal mystery. Nothing was explained in this one. The mystery at the end was still a mystery. It was really vague and totally not what I expected it to be. And then we have Confess by Colleen Hoover for its own reasons. I think I gave both of these books, by the way, a 1.5 out of 5 stars. All These Bodies because it felt totally not worked out well, in my opinion, the mystery. And Confess because there are just so many ridiculous plot lines and the relationship feels so weird, strained, toxic. I also felt like kind of like abuse was used to continue on the plot and the story. And I just don't know if Colleen Hoover is it for me. I do own Verity by her, but that's a thriller. It's a completely different genre from what she usually writes. But I think her romances are just not it for me, but I want to try at least one more of them, which has been more like recently published because Confess came out in 2015, 2016. There are definitely some old, like for instance, slut-shaming comments that are made in this book. So yeah, don't read Confess. I would not recommend it. Number 6, my biggest surprise. Again, I would have to say Beach Read, just because I was not expecting to love a romance book as much as I did with that one. Perfect combination of romance and seriousness. That's all I want to say about it, because otherwise I'll be rambling on about this book for 5 more minutes and I'm not allowing myself to do that. Okay, one more time, because my favorite new author is Emily Henry. I mean, within the span of 3 months, I have bought and read all 3 of her romance novels. And let me give you like an unofficial ranking of all 3 of them. I think I'm gonna have a little bit of an unpopular opinion because Book Lovers is super popular right now and everyone is loving it. I did love it. I just don't think I enjoyed our 2 main characters as much as in the other 2 books. The setting, a small town, was absolutely wonderful. So this is my number 3. Then I think on number 2, I have You and Me on Vacation. It's about Alex and Poppy, and they have been going on summer vacation trips every single summer. And it's a friends to lovers romance, which is so well executed. And I know the whole book community is like all about enemies to lovers, but if you have a friends to lovers, which is worked out so well, oh, it just hits the spot. It hits differently. And then obviously, but also because it was my first Emily Henry book, I just feel like I have a little bit of a bias towards this book. So this is my number 1 and can't wait for her to publish more. Question number 9 is newest favorite character. And I always find this so hard, but until so far, I don't have any strong opinions on the characters that I've read. Well, I have strong opinions if I dislike them, but right now, not a character pops into my mind for newest favorite character. I'm sorry. Number 10 is a book that made you cry, or books, but one pops out in particular and it has cry in the title, which is Don't Cry For Me by Daniel Black. But this book made me have a full-on like panic attack. Well, not a panic attack, but anxiety attack, let's put it that way, because in this one we follow our main character, who is the father of a gay son, and he never accepted that his son was gay. And now that he's on his deathbed, he's writing all these letters to his son talking about how he came to that perspective and how he came to be the person that he has been over the past couple of years. And it was so interesting to kind of like read the story from the perspective of the one who did harm to their child. And this book is, I feel like, so well worked out, because it doesn't make everything that the father did to his gay son like acceptable, like totally not at all. It's a very nuanced book. I'm just really bad at reviewing books, hence why it's difficult for me to exactly word my intricate thoughts and feelings on it. Cindy wrote an amazing review of this book that I completely agree with, so if you want to read her exact opinion, it's right here. She did it so well. But because our main character is dying and is like so alone, it's a very depressing book, and it really triggered my anxiety. So this wasn't just like crying because I felt sad. It was also crying because of my anxiety. So advice from me to you, read this when you're in a good mental health space, because then it's a gorgeous book to read. If you're not in a good mental health space, give yourself some time, honey. A book that made you happy. Until so far, I have read like funny, lighthearted books, but the only ones that I would kind of fully put into this category are the Giant Days comic novels. I've only read volume 1 and 2 this year, but I really want to continue on with the series. They're just really easy to read. I love the art style, and it's about like this friend group who goes to college, and you basically follow their lives there, which is very enjoyable. They're very funny, and also some hectic stuff happens, so I would really recommend it to you. Number 12, the most beautiful book that I have either received or bought this year, and I have received from Fairyloot in one of their boxes, Daughter of the Moon Goddess by Su Lin Tan. And this is, I think, the first book in a duology, the Fairyloot edition. I mean, like all Fairyloot editions, to be honest, they are the most beautiful books that I receive always, because they have like special end pages, usually something of art in the dust jacket, a special dust jacket, and on the front cover of the hardcover they do like all these embossed designs, which is just so beautiful, and this one is my absolute fave. And then the last question is a book that you need to read by the end of this year. I am scared to pick this one up, and that is A Court of Wings and Ruin by Sarah J. Maas. I have reread Akamath, A Court of Wings and Fury, in May. I have thoughts and opinions. Are they all positive? No. Do I want to make like a dedicated video on this trilogy? Yes. Am I scared to pick up this 700 page book? Absolutely. Am I gonna do it? You bet. I really loved Akamath when it came out 5 or 6 years ago, but giving it a reread, my opinion has changed a little bit. So am I super excited to pick up this one? No. But I have really, like, you know, reread Akamath to finally finish a series by Sarah J. Maas, and I'm gonna do that, okay? I'm gonna hold myself to the promise. You need to hold me to this promise. So I hope that I'll be able to pick this one up somewhere this summer. I am so blessed that the audiobook is on script, because otherwise I don't think I would be able to make it through this. I just don't know if I'm ready to cringe even more sometimes between like Resans and Feyre's Romance, because they can definitely be cringeworthy, okay? This was my yearbook freak out tag 2022 edition. Definitely let me know your answer to question number 1 as well, which is the best book that you've read so far in 2022. I'm really curious to hear your thoughts and opinions. I hope that you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, please give it a thumbs up. You can subscribe to my channel by clicking somewhere here on the screen or in the button down below, and hopefully I will see you guys in the next one. Bye. Thank you.